Thought has to do with, of course, Memorial Day. And it's a time for honoring and mourning U.S. military personnel who have died while serving the United States Armed Forces. We know that it's also the unofficial beginning of summer, so that happened. The National Cemetery Administration has credited Mary Ann Williams with originating the idea of strewing the graves of Civil War soldiers, both Union and Confederate soldiers, with flowers. I'm going to read a bit of a poem. It's a very long poem, but I'm only going to read you a few lines from it. After the Civil War ended, Abraham Lincoln was assassinated on 14th of April in 1865 while at Ford's Theater. He actually died the next morning. And Walt Whitman wrote a poem to him that I think you've probably all read, called When Lilacs Last in the Dooryard Bloomed. Although Walt Whitman wrote this poem as an elegy for President Abraham Lincoln, it also encompasses, I think, and illuminates more than 600,000 people who died in the Civil War, and there are future echoes. It reaches forward in time to World War I, World War II, the Korean War, Vietnam, Iraq, Afghanistan, to honor all veterans who died while serving in the U.S. Armed Forces. There are a few lines from When Lilacs Last in the Dooryard Bloomed. One, when lilacs last in the dooryard bloomed, and the great star early drooped in the western sky in the night, I mourned, and yet shall mourn with ever-returning spring. Three, in the dooryard fronting an old farmhouse near the whitewashed palings, stands the lilac bush, tall growing with heart-shaped leaves of rich green, with many a pointed blossom rising delicate, with a perfume strong I love, with every leaf a miracle, and from this bush in the dooryard, with delicate colored blossoms and heart-shaped leaves of rich green, a sprig with its flower I break. From the end of part six, here, coffin that slowly passes, I give you my sprig of life. And then the last three lines of this poem. For the sweetest, wisest soul of all my days and lands, and this for his dear sake, lilac and star and bird twined with the chant of my soul there in the fragrant pines and the cedars, dusk and dim. So for all of those soldiers who have died on the country's behalf, I want to say amen. And you can stand for the song if you are able.
Thank you. Good morning again. That was a little loud. Step over here. It's a beautiful day. It's a beautiful weekend. I know you will probably hear this a few more times this weekend, but happy Memorial Day weekend. The weekend that we do honor those who have served and those who are serving, those who have given the greatest gift of their lives to ensure our freedom and to make a difference in this world. And I don't know if you're like me, but also this weekend makes me think of those who have passed away, family members, friends, those who are still remain in our hearts. So I just invite you, as we prepare for this time of prayer, to think of those individuals, those who need God's hand upon them if they're facing their toughest battles right now, those who have made such significant sacrifices. Because we come to this time each Sunday to really offer ourselves to God. To open up our hearts, our minds, to the one who knows us best. And so here in a moment, as we've developed this tradition, I invite you to pause for a moment of silent reflection, to just lift up your thoughts, your prayers, your praises to our Almighty God, the one who can do all things when we feel like all things are hopeless, the one who gave the great sacrifice of his Son so that we can know life even better here on this earth, and know eternal life. So if you will, please open up your hearts, your minds, your souls to our gracious God, and then we'll continue together in prayer. O gracious God, our Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning in the name of your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross for us, who was raised to new life, that we may hold on to this promise of everlasting life, knowing that you are with us throughout every day, season, and trial of life, as well as during the good times of joy and praise. And Lord, we pray in the power of the Holy Spirit as we gather here this morning. We are truly thankful for this day that you have blessed us with, the gift of life, the breath of life that's renewed in us each and every day. Thank you, Lord. And as we gather here this morning, I ask that you will just pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, each and every one of us, for those who have prayers that we have either shared or that we keep close to our hearts, that you hear those prayers, that you know those needs, that you will speak into our lives in a powerful way, that your will and purpose be done, because we know that in your good will, you desire the best for us, even when we go through difficult, heart-wrenching times. And so, Lord, we turn to you for your guidance, your wisdom, your provision. We lift up those who really need to feel your hand upon them, your presence as the great physician, to help them face their toughest medical concerns or their most difficult ailments in life or their most formidable hardships, that you, Lord, as the great provider and the great physician, the great healer, the great strengthener, our great friend, will speak into their lives, bring healing and strength and comfort. And Lord, we ask that as we gather here, that you will fill us with joy as we come to worship you, to give you thanks, to give you praise for the life that you've given to us. For we cannot sit here or stand here and praise without your hand opening all those doors in our lives, without so many people who have made such a significant difference in our lives. Without you blessing us each and every day, Lord, we couldn't be here today, so thank you. We honor you. We honor those who have given so much for us today. We ask that you will be with us as a church family, as a community, as a body of believers together, as those with family members and friends and people in this town that we come here and represent just by being here. We ask that you will be with us and strengthen us and guide us, that this service through its music, through its word, through the sharing of scripture will be honorable and pleasing to you. And in your holy name, Lord, we pray all of these things, and together we say, amen. As we pray and lift up our prayers to our gracious God, we also can ask for his blessings upon what we can give of our time and our talents and our donations and offerings. So if you will, join with me in asking God's blessings upon these gifts, these offerings, these donations of time and talent. Heavenly Father, again we come to you, asking that you would bless these gifts, these offerings, these donations of time and talent. May you bless them and multiply them so that your kingdom grows not only here at this church or in Loveland, but here and throughout the world. Because by your hand you can do mighty things, and we pray this in your holy name, and together we say, together for the beauty of the earth.
Over and above.
as you're able to, I invite you, since it is a holiday weekend, since we are family and friends, even if we don't quite know each other, I invite you to turn around to your neighbors, say good morning, shake a hand if you would like. If you'd like to take just a moment and walk around and say hello to others, let's celebrate this day. Sunday should be a celebration.
How are you?
How are you?
Hi.
Good morning again, Drew.
It's good to stand up, especially before the sermon. So let's get that energy and get ready to sit just for a little while this morning. But Sunday is a time to celebrate, to say hello, to just share in the love that brings us here because of the love of Jesus Christ. And I'm going to share a little secret with you. It may not be a big secret, and maybe you've heard other pastors talk about this before. But when I was just a church attendee, and then a church member, and then as I became involved and called to ministry, I've always wondered how other pastors prepare their messages and what sort of guidance that they receive and what sort of research do they perform when they preach. And it's all over the board. There are some who won't even make an outline but bring their Bible up here and preach according to what the Holy Spirit speaks to them. And some do really good at that. And then others, because I've experienced these moments, sometimes you will forget what you say, or your mind might go blank, or when you're standing up here, it's an entirely different perspective. And the Holy Spirit can leave you silent, too, sometimes. Some people say amen to that, but sometimes you can lose your train of thought, or go off on a rabbit trail. Others write a full manuscript. They will write page after page after page. I don't have that, so don't worry. But some will stand there and read their manuscript because that's their style, and some do a wonderful job with that. The problem with reading via a manuscript, though, is sometimes you get so caught up on making sure you say the right words that you end up misspeaking. And then others do like an outline, which is something that I do, but the reason that I share all of this is that before each Sunday, in all honesty, and throughout the week, I'm in prayer, I'm in thought, in periods of reflection of what God wants me to say about the particular season that I'm in, and the particular season you are in, and the particular season that we are in as a church family, or as believers throughout the world, or just as people throughout the world. And each Sunday when I stand up here, it's not to hear myself speak. Christy hears enough of that. I could record myself and play it back, and I don't want to do that. It's because I truly believe in what the Lord has said and recorded here in the Bible, but also through the experience of other people and what He's doing in our lives. And there's such a power to that. There's such a power. So everything I bring to you, I really believe is useful for us. And so today, we'll get into it in just a few minutes, but if you want to go to your Bible or Bible app, we're going to look at 1 Samuel 1. So we're going to go back to the Old Testament a little bit, but just looking at the first chapter of 1 Samuel. So if you want to go to your Bible and keep your thumb there, or go into your Bible app, we're going to look at 1 Samuel 1. And the topic I want to talk about, I actually entitled Surrender Splendor. And a little attempt at alliteration there, but Surrender Splendor. And I want you to think about these words here for a moment. There is a splendor to surrender when we make a sacrifice towards a greater promise or purpose or to a greater future. There is a splendor to surrender when we make a sacrifice towards a greater promise, a greater purpose, a greater future. And the idea I'm trying to get at here is that There is a splendor, something greater than ourselves, something beautiful, something magnificent. When we surrender meaning that it may be a substantial sacrifice of time or of our resources or of life, but surrender our thoughts, surrender our emotions, surrender our time to something that is more fulfilling or something that will do more for others or something that points to a greater promise. Even if it means we have to look beyond our own interests for the moment. And with it being Memorial Day weekend, I reflected on this because as I waited at the Nashville airport to come back home on Thursday because the flight had to be changed, I got the chance to sit there for 6 hours because my only ride into Nashville was early in the morning, which was okay. But when you get to sit in the airport for 6 hours, it's a whole lot of fun, isn't it? You get really creative in how to spend your time. And you can only walk the airport so often, but you get past the security gates and you're happy, TSA, you're happy, you're ready to just get on the plane. But while I was sitting there, and sitting in a different section of the terminal, as another United flight came in and people were going to be departing to go to Newark, New Jersey, as they said, even the ramp agent said, well, if you're going to Newark, it's probably because you're on your way to a better place. You just got to change planes. But as I sat there looking out the window as this plane that just came in and was going to go to Newark, New Jersey, I thought it was quite odd how there was a pause in the loading of the plane. And the pilot got out of the plane, you know, he went through the jet ramp and down the stairs, and he greeted a person who pulled up in a golf cart. And this individual that came out of the golf cart was dressed in full military uniform. He was from the 101st Airborne Division, stationed up in Fort Campbell, Tennessee. And he was an airborne ranger. And he stood by the conveyor belt that loads luggage into the plane. And the first item to be loaded into that plane was a white casket. And this officer saluted the casket of a fallen soldier as it went up the ramp. And the ramp agent herself, with tears in her voice, announced to all those who were waiting to get on the plane, who didn't fully know what was going on, that as you enter this plane and as you leave, do so in remembrance of those who have given so much, including the family of this man who has just lost his life, giving of himself to others. And of course, what she said was more broken up by the sobs and the tears in her voice. A stranger, the ramp agent, just reminding individuals that on that plane was a fallen soldier. That's a pretty significant example of surrender. Surrender of your life for the benefit and blessing of others. And it points to love. That's part of the splendor that comes out of surrender. When we look beyond ourselves into a bigger picture. And Jesus gives us an example of this. Before we get into our scripture, I just have a short passage. And it comes from the Gospel of Mark. And Jesus himself has been tested by some of the legal experts, some of the most religious individuals, whom we talk about as Pharisees, some of the leaders in the temple, the religious experts. They have come to grill Jesus, to test him. And one religious expert asks Jesus, you know, what is the greatest commandment then? What is the one thing you should do? What is the greatest commandment of all? And of course, if you've been in church world or you've read the Bible a little bit, or maybe you've just heard this, you know, of course, it is to love thy God, your Father, with all your heart, mind, and soul. To love your neighbor like yourself. That love. And so the part I want to share here is the religious man's response. And he says, well said, teacher. The man replied, you are right in saying that God is one and there is no other but him. So love him. Surrender all of your emotions. Love him with all of your heart, with all of your understanding, and with all of your strength. And to love your neighbor as yourself is more important than all burnt offerings and sacrifices. That was his reply. That love, to love your neighbor, is more important than all the burnt offerings and sacrifices. So all the things that they could have surrendered back then. And I understand we're in a different culture. We don't understand the sacrificial system. So we don't know exactly how their sacrifices meant so much to them in our modern day. But it was part of their worship. You make a sacrifice, you surrender something. You surrender a burnt offering. And I'm not talking about dad cooking the hamburgers, overcooking the hamburgers and steaks on Memorial Day weekend. That happens sometimes. That's not a burnt offering. It's surrendering the very best that you have to give to God. And we can do that in a different way through love. And there is a splendor and a beauty to it that will change the world. So to surrender is to see the bigger perspective, the bigger picture. And that's kind of where I want to start as we really dive into 1 Samuel. To surrender is to see the bigger perspective, the bigger picture, because I suggest to you, I've seen it in my own life, and I have to be reminded about this, and maybe you need to as well, that faith really only grows when we live and when we look beyond ourselves. The greater goal, the bigger picture, faith, real faith, not just sitting in the pew and waiting for the cookies later, which I shared before, is really good. Fellowship is a part of it. But real faith, faith that makes a difference when you're down and out and you're in the valley and you're trudging through the worst circumstances of life where you don't know what tomorrow will bring. Faith really grows when we live and when we look beyond ourselves. And one of the best examples comes from the Old Testament, the Jewish scriptures, when we talk about Samuel. And so the chapter opens up talking about Elkanah. And Elkanah, he's a faithful man. And it says here, starting in verse 2, that Elkanah, he had two wives. One was called Hannah, and the other was Penina. So we had two wives. That's strange for our culture, of course. But here's why he has two wives. Penina had children, but Hannah had none. Year after year, this man went up from his town. So he's faithful. Elkanah is faithful. He goes every year to follow the religious rules and establishment. He leaves every year from his town to worship and to sacrifice, so to surrender his very best to the Lord Almighty at Shiloh, where Hophni and Phinehas, the two sons of the high priest Eli, were priests of the Lord. And whenever the day came for Elkanah to sacrifice, he would give portions of the meat to his wife Peninnah and to all her sons and daughters. But to Hannah, he gave a double portion because he loved her. Another type of surrender and sacrifice. He really loved Hannah. He gave a double portion, extra meat, from his sacrifice because he loved her and the Lord had closed her womb. Hannah could not have children. And I know we're so far removed from this ancient day, this ancient world in which this was recorded, but I still think it carries weight today because in that culture, to desire to have a family, to desire to have children, and to be barren, to be unable to, would be the greatest embarrassment and setback and hurt for a woman to not be able to have a child and a family. And it carries weight for us today because we could read over this part, but it's expressly recorded for us that the reason she could not have children. Even though all the attention Elkanah is providing to her, and extra food and extra care, because he loves her so much, is because the Lord had closed her womb. Those words are significant. The Lord had closed her womb. The Lord had allowed this to happen. Why is that? I can't tell you. There are a number of experiences in the Bible, and a number of experiences in my life, and probably a number of experiences in your life that we cannot truly explain in full detail, and that's okay. The Lord has a purpose. But faith really grows when we have to live and to look beyond ourselves. And in this story, the plot remains just as strong even when the language changes to today, in that there is barrenness and brokenness in this world. Hannah was barren. And there are moments of barrenness in this world. Again, more than often, unexplainable. Brokenness. Pain that hurts, no matter how much someone might be able to give to you of physical things, affection, or like in this case, double whoppers, big devotions of meat, the best of the meat that Hannah received instead of Peninnah, didn't really matter because there was a deep down brokenness. The Lord allowed it. And that means we need to recognize the brokenness in this world and to share what we can in a way that connects with the heart, with others. Recognize the brokenness, share in a way that recognizes the splendor the Lord wants us to see. And we'll get more into this story about what it means. But think about it in this regard for a moment. You remember your favorite childhood movies? Raise your hands. It's okay. No one's looking. Don't be bashful. Think of your favorite childhood movies. Did you try to share those movies with your own son or daughter or grandchild or niece or nephew? Did you ever sit down and invite them to come watch those movies with you? I have. I was so excited, and I don't see John back there at the moment, but there he is. I was so excited to share some of my favorite childhood movies with John. I don't remember all of them, but some of them were Disney animations, and then a movie called The Neverending Story, which freaked me out as a kid, but it still had a powerful message, and I liked it, and I tried to share it with him. And then movies even like Top Gun, because when I saw that as a kid, man, it made me want to go into the Air Force or the Navy to fly those jets. I loved some of these movies, and I knew that they would connect in a way with John that would just really strike his heart, and he would experience the same thing. And so we sat down to watch some of these movies. On each one, I expected John to be seated at the edge of his seat, laughing at the same things I'm laughing at that I laughed at years ago. Crying at the same things I may have started to cry about. And every time I looked over there, you know what he was doing? Looking around like, John, are you bored? Why aren't you laughing? Or some of the movies he's saying, man, he's almost basically twiddling his thumbs. And I'm thinking, wow, hey, don't you understand why this is so good? Let me explain it. Listen to those words, let me explain it. When you have to say, let me explain it, you have already lost. Trust me. I couldn't understand why he did not see and hear and laugh at the same things I did. And then I thought, well, that's okay though. The plot of the story, the purpose and the theme and the moral of the story still remains the same, but culture changes. And the way to speak to others changes. But yet, to surrender, to connect, To see the splendor of God working through the toughest situations is still a way to connect, even if that language changes. Even if our perspective of movies changes, that story still remains powerful. And it remains powerful because a holy God, a God that is holy, can still allow a hole in the heart. And that's something that still happens in life, that you can still have a hole in your heart, but there still is a holy God who is there in our lives, who is there waiting to intervene, a God who wants to hear from us. Because if we continue in this story, we cannot just leave it at verse 5 because it would be an unfulfilled story. If we continue on in verse 6, again we're reminded that because the Lord had closed Hannah's womb, her rival, the other wife, kept provoking Hannah in order to irritate her. Kept provoking, making fun of her. Why? Because she had the children. She had the established family. She had the heritage. She had the promise. And so, sometimes when you think you have everything, or it's going your way, it's easier to make fun of those who don't have it, who are walking in that brokenness. It's just a fact of life, of human nature. And it says this went on year after year after year. And whenever Hannah went up to the house of the Lord, so when she went along to worship, her rival provoked her until she wept and she would not eat. That provocation and torment was so bad that Hannah got to the point she didn't want to eat. And she was just drenched with tears. All she could do is weep, deep down weeping. That brokenness that comes up through your tears and your broken heart. And her husband, Elkanah, would say to her, Hannah, why are you weeping? Why don't you eat? Why are you so downhearted? These are the things husbands say, you know, like, well, just cheer up, just calm down. Why are you crying? Worst response ever, right? Well, it gets worse because Elkanah says, of course, why are you disheartened? Why are you downtrodden? Why are you downhearted? Don't I mean more to you than 10 sons? Doesn't being married to me mean more than having 10 sons? You think Hannah cried even more at that? I bet you she did. Not that he was trying to say anything rude, but he's like, we're married. We have something special. But yet, if you want to be a mother, there's nothing like having that child. Especially when you cannot. That was a deep hole in her heart. Just as you may have experienced a deep hole in your heart. Maybe now, maybe in the past, maybe another one will occur in the future. And a holy God can handle all that and remind us that when we surrender to Him, He can help us to handle it. I've heard this phrase over and over, that if God closes one door, He does what? Open another. I think that's true. I think there is truth to that. If God closes one door, He opens another. But you know what? Waiting in the hallway, wandering in the hallway between those two doors is the most difficult part. And that's really what transforms us, is how we handle that waiting in the hallway. How we try to understand this brokenness, this barrenness, this hurt. Because folks, you probably know this. I hope you do. There is so much hurt in this world. And there is so much good that we can do if we surrender to show God's splendor. There is so much we can do. It doesn't mean you have to hop on a plane and fly halfway across the world. It means if you have the right heart, God will speak to you, to me, to others, to make a tremendous difference. If you care enough to think of these people. And that is a catch. You say, well, Pastor, that's ridiculous. Of course I care. Well, it means caring to the extent that we are willing to surrender something. And God does not always speak to us in the ways we wish He would. Hannah, in this story, as an example, is weeping. She refuses to eat. She is making herself physically sick. Why doesn't God just speak to her and let her know that it's going to be okay? Have you ever had a moment like that? Seriously, this is where faith becomes real. This is not just a sermon to tickle your ear and then, again, we just go on to fellowship. Have you ever really had a moment where you did not understand why God is not speaking to you in the midst of this tragedy or difficulty? I have. More than likely, you have too. Some of you know about this journey that I'm making with my brother. And I'll tell you what, I was, after being gone for a week and a half or whatever it was, when I left here, it didn't seem like the grass was so green or the trees were so green. I leave, and I think you guys somehow got more rain than Tennessee. And if you haven't lived in the South, that is quite an achievement that you get more rain here than the South, because I come back and everything is lush and green and beautiful. But as I'm the one who's ordained, the one who has been to seminary, is trying to understand what God is doing in the midst of our family and this world, I'm the one still waiting to hear God to speak. And there in Tennessee, on the land where in the house where my mom and brother have lived, you can go out there when it's late at night, and sometimes you see the sky filled with stars like diamonds tossed out with black film. And again, faith gets real in certain moments, and you go out there. I've gone out there to say, God, why is this happening? I know you are a holy God, but why are there holes in our hearts? And I've gone out there asking, God, I need you to speak to me. Lord, will you speak to me? Come down and we'll have some coffee. You know God likes coffee because your Bibles have a book called Hebrews. Get it? Okay. I know that's bad. But God's got to love coffee. But why can't He just come down and have a cup of coffee? Well, I don't know. But God speaks to our hearts. And I will tell you this, though. As I'm asking these questions, as I'm frustrated on some nights and then others more reflective, on the night before I left, I'm out there asking these questions, just like Hannah has and did, as many others have. I'm out there asking, Lord, I just wish to hear from you. What can I do? And the best I can do at the moment is to say the Lord's Prayer. And as I finish saying the Lord's Prayer, the most magnificent falling star, bright white star, falls across the sky, just above the horizon before my eyes. Make of it what you will. But that spoke to the hole in my heart at that moment. God will speak to where we're at if we will allow Him to. And here's where Hannah's story really starts coming to focus for our life, because Hannah had a problem. And we experience problems. But a problem is not the detour, and it is not the true obstacle we make it out to be. A problem is a part of the progression towards the promise. A problem is a part of the progression. You're making progress towards a promise when you go through a problem. I can prove it if we skip down a little bit further. If we go verses 9 through 18 of 1 Samuel. Of course, Hannah won't eat. She's crying. And our story continues that once the family, so Elkanah and Hannah and the others, once they had finished eating and drinking while in Shiloh to worship the Lord, Hannah stood up. Now Eli the priest, he was sitting on his chair by the doorpost of the Lord's house. Probably like sitting on the front porch in the cool of the night. He's sitting out there. And in her deep anguish, Hannah prayed to the Lord, weeping bitterly. And she made a vow, a surrender, a sacrifice. She made a vow saying, Lord Almighty, If you will only look on your servant's misery and remember me and not forget your servant, but give her a son. But give her a son. Then I will surrender. I will give him to the Lord for all the days of his life, and no razor will ever be used on his head. And the Nazarite tradition that he will be holy unto the Lord. No razor will ever be used on his head. His hair will not be cut. He will be dedicated to the Lord. As she kept on praying to the Lord, Eli, again, the high priest, the expert, the religious leader, sitting in his chair in the cool of the night, observed her mouth. Hannah was praying in her heart, deep down in her heart, and her lips were moving, but her voice was not heard. What did Eli, the high priest, the know-it-all, think? Eli thought that she was drunk and said to her, "How long are you going to stay drunk? Put away your wine." Think of that. All the provocation she has faced, her weeping, her tears, her hunger. And the high priest is saying, "You're drunk because you're mouthing things I cannot hear. You must be drunk. Put away your wine." You know, sometimes people will really push that button when you're going through the worst. And she says, "Not so, my Lord," with a little L, "not so, my Lord, priest Eli," Hannah replied. "I am a woman who is deeply troubled. I have not been drinking wine or beer. I was pouring out my soul. I was pouring out my soul, surrender, sacrifice, pouring out my soul to the Lord. Do not take your servant for a wicked woman. I have been praying here out of my great anguish and grief." And Eli said, "Go in peace. And may the God of Israel grant you what you have asked of him." And she said, "May your servant find favor in your eyes." Then she went away and she ate some. And then her face was no longer downcast. Why was she no longer sad? She had prayed and poured out her heart. She had done the best she could in that moment of surrender. Then she went and she ate some. She nourished the body as well. She didn't feel so bad after that. A problem is a part of the progression towards a promise. And don't take for granted that people will provoke you in your problems, or things will happen to agitate or to increase that problem. And people will misjudge you, just like Eli misjudged Hannah. But God will still give voice to your words, even when they're whispered. She spoke from the heart. The words were not audible, but God still gave voice to what she spoke from her heart. So that type of deep down surrender, it's not to cover something up. It's not just wishful thinking, but it's to see with wide open eyes that go down to the soul. Surrender like that to the Lord can't be rushed. It's going to take some time. It's going to take some prayer. It's going to take surrendering our hearts. It cannot be rushed. Yes, there are moments in life where we rush things. The thing that came to mind when I was reading that is that the last apartment that we had to move out of, you know, you try to pack and you fill boxes after boxes and boxes and you have everything planned out, but time still runs out and you've got to be out of that apartment. And then the last one that we were at, Austin liked to hang a lot of artwork with push pins. It's great because it's like a nail. It doesn't leave a tremendous hole in the wall, a small one. But Austin used all these push pins to hang artwork. Beautiful stuff, right? It's typical. But when you take all those pins out, you could really have a lot of fun with connected dots. You could make all sorts of things. I think we've had an elephant, you know, the Big Dipper, and you can name it. Connect the dots. But you get charged for having the pinholes in the wall in the apartment world if you haven't been there for a while. So, not being able to, you know, spackle or put anything on the wall ourselves real quickly, I found something on the internet that said use toothpaste. Here in the last minute of trying to get out of this apartment, we filled those holes with toothpaste. Colgate Total, to be exact. So we filled holes and pot cavities at the same time. It was a rush to cover something up. Surrender isn't like that. Surrender takes time, day after day after day. Surrender isn't just giving up something that is undesirable to us, kind of that joke about Lent. Like if you recognize Lent, you're going to give up something that you really don't mind giving up. If you don't like coffee, you don't mind giving up coffee or fill in the blank. Surrender is giving up our very best to see a bigger picture. And it pays off because if we skip down just a little bit further, the last two verses I want to share with you. Hannah has a son. He is named Samuel. And she goes back when Samuel is older to make a sacrifice, to worship at the temple in Shiloh. And one of the sacrifices was a bull sacrifice. And it says in verse 25, when the bull had been sacrificed, the family then brought the boy to Eli, the high priest. And Hannah said to Eli, pardon me, my lord, as surely as you live, remember I am the woman who stood here beside you, praying to the Lord. I pray for this child, and the Lord has given me this beautiful boy. He has granted me what I have asked of him. The story doesn't end there. She says, so now I give him, I surrender him to the Lord. For his whole life he will be given, surrendered over to the Lord, and he will worship the Lord forever. And Samuel worshiped as a young boy the Lord right then and there. Again, we're in 2023, and we don't always see the significance of that. How many of you would hand over your only child to the high priest, to become a servant of the Lord, but to say, I will no longer see you. You will no longer live in my house. I surrender all that I have because I made this promise to the Lord for the goal of a bigger promise, a bigger purpose. To surrender like that is to fully experience God's splendor. Surrender that hurts, but also makes a tremendous difference. Why does this matter to us? What do you have to surrender? That's my question for you. What do you have that you need to surrender? On a personal level, it can be a number of things. It could be a habit that we know detracts from all that we want to achieve. It could be surrendering our attempts to control things or to try to get our will done or to manipulate things or our displeasure or our grumpiness. Something that is detracting from what the Lord really wants us to see. Yeah, on a personal level, that's something we need to surrender. Now, here's the big thing. As I've thought about this, as I've read this scripture, and as I've studied over it, and here's where I really invite your attention. What do you have to surrender? And what comes to my heart is your church. What do you have to surrender? Your church. This church. And I use that word in a way that this church belongs to the Lord. You know, throughout my church-going life, I have heard people say, well, I've gone to this church for 53 years. That should account for something. Well, yes, it does. That's wonderful. That's wonderful. You have been blessed to come to a place that you love and has become home. But it's still the Lord's church. No amount of time, fill in the blanks, means that everything needs to be done my way or this way. It's the Lord's church. And if we want to see the bigger picture that will make a difference in those who are experiencing barrenness and brokenness and pain in their lives, then we're going to have to surrender something. Whether how we want to hear music performed, whether how we want to see the services held, whether it's the things that we need to change that are hard to let go of. Surrender to the Lord will be blessed if our hearts are right. And you talking to everyone gathered here. You are in the best position right now, more than ever, to make a surrender that God can honor and bless, if you are able to do so. The best chance right now to see the Lord at work, to surrender and to fully experience God's splendor, can be a blessing to others if we can do that. And that's the question you need to ask. May God bless this message today, which shares His word. Together, let us say, Amen. With that being said, I invite you, as you're able, to please rise. Let's sing together unto the Lord the song that we practiced earlier, Try a Little Time. God bless you and have a wonderful day. Amen.